dear friends in Christ, on this most holy night in which our Lord Jesus passed over from death to life, the Church invites her members, dispersed throughout the world, to linger in vigil and prayer. For this is the Passover of the Lord, in which by hearing His word and recalling our baptism into His death and resurrection, we share in His victory over death, as we await a time when we will gather again together at God's holy altar. Let us pray. O God, through your Son, you have bestowed upon your people the brightness of your light. Sanctify this new fire, and grant that in this Paschal celebration we may so burn with heavenly desires that with pure minds we may attain to the festival of everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Yesterday, today, the beginning and the end, Alpha and Omega, all time belongs to Him, and all ages. To Him be glory and power in every age, forever and ever. Amen. By His holy and glorious wounds, may Christ our Lord guard us and keep us. Amen. May the light of Christ, rising in glory, banish all darkness from our hearts and minds.
Rejoice now, heavenly host and choirs of angels, and let your trumpet shout salvation, for the victory of our mighty King. Rejoice and sing now all the round earth, bright with a glorious splendor. For darkness has been vanquished by our eternal King. Rejoice and be glad now, Mother Church, and let your holy courts in radiant light resound with the praises of your people. All you who stand near this marvelous and holy flame, pray with me to God the Almighty for the grace to sing the worthy praise of this great light. Through Jesus Christ, his Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with him in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and good, always and everywhere, with our whole heart and mind and voice to praise you, the invisible, almighty, and eternal God, and your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb, who at the feast of the Passover paid for us the debt of Adam's sin, and by his blood delivered your faithful people. This is the night when you brought our fathers, the children of Israel, out of bondage in Egypt, and led them through the Red Sea on dry land. This is the night when all who believe in Christ are delivered from the gloom of sin and are restored to grace and holiness of life. This is the night when Christ broke the bonds of death and hell and rose victorious from the grave. How wonderful and beyond our knowing, O God, is your mercy and loving kindness to us, that to redeem a slave you gave a son. How holy is this night, when wickedness is put to flight and sin is washed away. It restores innocence to the fallen and joy to those who mourn. It casts out pride and hatred and brings peace and concord. How blessed is this night, when earth and heaven are joined, and man is reconciled to God. Holy Father, accept our evening sacrifice, the offering of this candle in your honor. May it shine continually to drive away all darkness. May Christ, the morning star who knows no He who gives his light to all creation and who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen.
Let us hear the record of God's saving deeds in history, how he saved his people in ages past. And let us pray that our God will bring each of us to the fullness of redemption.
The Creation by James Weldon Johnson. And God stepped out on space, and he looked around and said, "I'm lonely. I'll make me a world." And far as the eye of God could see, darkness covered everything, blacker than 100 midnights down in a cypress swamp. Then God smiled, and the light broke, and the darkness rolled up on one side, and the light stood shining on the other. And God said, "That's good." Then God reached out and took the light in his hands, and God rolled the light around in his hands until he made the sun. And he sat that sun ablazing in the heavens, and the light that was left from making the sun, God gathered it up in a shining ball and flung it against the darkness, spangling the light with the moon and stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world, and God said, "That's good." Then God himself stepped down, and the sun was on his right hand, and the moon was on his left. The stars were clustered about his head, and the earth was under his feet. And God walked, and where he trod, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. Then he stopped and looked and saw that the earth was hot and barren. So God stepped over the edge of the world, and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes, and the lightnings flashed. He clapped his hands, and the thunders rolled, and the waters above the earth came down, the cooling waters came down. Then the green grass sprouted, and the little red flowers blossomed. The pine tree pointed his finger to the sky, and the oak spread out his arms. The lakes cuddled down in the hollows of the ground, and the rivers ran down to the sea. And God smiled again, and the rainbow appeared and curled itself around his shoulder. Then God raised his arm, and he waved his hand over the sea and over the land, and he said, "Bring forth, bring forth." And quicker than God could drop his hand, fishes and fowls and beasts and birds swam the rivers and the seas, roamed the forests and the woods, and split the air with their wings. And God said, "That's good." Then God walked around, and God looked around on all that he had made. He looked at his sun, and he looked at his moon, and he looked at his little stars. He looked on his world with all its living things, and God said, "I'm lonely still." Then God sat down on the side of a hill where he could think. By a deep, wide river he sat down. With his head in his hands, God thought and thought, till he thought, "I'll make me a man." Up from the bed of the river, God scooped the clay, and by the bank of the river he kneeled him down. And there the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who flung the stars to the most far corner of the night, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hand, this great God, like a mammy bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, toiling over a lump of clay, till he shaped it in his own image. Then into it he blew the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the 14th chapter of Exodus, beginning at the 10th verse. As Pharaoh drew near, the Israelites looked back, and there were the Egyptians advancing on them. In great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us alone and let us serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." But Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to keep still." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. But you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry ground. Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians so that they will go in after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord when I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots and his chariot drivers." The angel of God, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was there with the darkness, and it lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged their chariot wheels so that they turned with difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth. As the Egyptians fled before it, the Lord tossed the Egyptians into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians. And Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work that the Lord did against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Then the prophet Miriam, Aaron's sister, took a tambourine in her hand, and all the women went out after her with tambourines and with dancing. And Miriam sang to them, "Sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. Horse and rider he has thrown into the sea." The word of the Lord.
Horse and rider are thrown to the sea, God of strength. Let us pray. O God, whose wonderful deeds of old shine forth even to our own day, you once delivered by the power of your mighty arm your chosen people from slavery under Pharaoh, to be a sign for us of the salvation of all nations by the waters of baptism. Grant that all the peoples of the earth may be numbered among the offspring of Abraham, and rejoice in the inheritance of Israel, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of Ezekiel. I will take you from the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove from your body the heart of stone, and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you, and make you follow my statutes, and be careful to observe my ordinances. Then you shall live in the land that I gave to your ancestors, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Veni, Sancte Spiritu. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal Mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who are reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
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 A reading from the book of Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of dry bones. He led me all around them. They were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and will cover you with skin and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and the flesh had come upon them, and the skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live." I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came onto them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, "Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, Our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, Thus says the Lord God, I'm going to open up your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, and I will bring you back to the land of Israel, and you shall know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people, I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Rejoicing comes with more.
pray. Almighty God, by the Passover of your Son, you have brought us out of sin into righteousness and out of death into life. Grant to those who are sealed by your Holy Spirit the will and the power to proclaim you to all the world through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A reading from Zephaniah.
Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem.
The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies.
The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more.
On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak.
The Lord, your God, is in the midst, a warrior who gives victory.
He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love.
He will exult over you with loud singing as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it.
I will deal with all your oppressors at that time. And I will save the lame and gather the outcast.
And I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At the time I will bring you home, and at the time when I gather you.
For I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth, when I restore your fortunes before your eyes, says the Lord.
Here ends the reading.
Shine for the kingdom of God.
be on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery, by the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Alleluia! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Night to shine with the glory of the Lord's resurrection.
Stir up in your church that spirit of adoption which is given to us in baptism, that we, being renewed both in body and mind, may worship you in sincerity and truth. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
After the Sabbath, as the first day of the week was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord, descending from heaven, came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. For fear of him, the guards shook and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has been raised from the dead. And indeed, he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him.' This is my message for you." So they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came to him, took hold of his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, where they will see me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Child, my family and I often drove from where we lived in either Berea or Richmond to see my relatives who lived in the Tri-Cities of East Tennessee. And so that meant that we went through the Cumberland Gap. And so we would go through the city of Pineville, Kentucky. And as a child, each time we went through the open floodgates of Pineville, I remember being awestruck at how big the floodgates seemed. They seemed huge, impenetrable. And I imagined, as a child, when I was shorter, what it would look like when the floodgates would close, that Pineville, Kentucky, would become a fortress, protected from anything that the Cumberland River could possibly do to it. I imagine that was the kind of impenetrability that Mary Magdalene and the other Mary thought they might be encountering at the tomb of Jesus. Now, we don't exactly know if the women are aware of the conversation between Pilate and the chief priests and the Pharisees, but in the passage that occurs just before our Gospel from Matthew for this service, we hear the next day, that is, after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember what that impostor said while he was still alive. 'After 3 days I will rise again.' Therefore, command the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may go and steal him away and tell the people, 'He has been raised from the dead.' And the last deception would be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, You have a guard of soldiers. Go. Make it as secure as you can. So they went with the guard and made the tomb secure by sealing the stone. Make it as secure as you can. We hear this theme of security a lot in the final chapters of Matthew. When the people who are to arrest Jesus come to him, they must have been afraid because they have clubs and swords. Peter, he is afraid that people will associate him with Jesus, and he thinks that he can find security in swearing that he does not know Jesus. And of course, we have Pilate saying that the tomb must be made as secure as it possibly can be. They think they are being smart, but in their being smart, they belie their fear. Jesus is a threat to these people. He has called them on their behaviors and their actions, and these leaders think that they have silenced him. But even in that, they still are afraid. They are trying their best to create security. And so, as I imagine the women approaching the tomb, I imagine that they wonder, as I wondered as a child, if I could ever possibly push those floodgates open or shut, whichever would be most helpful to the people of Pineville. Would the Marys be able to push the stone away from the tomb? The stone that had been sealed? Could they do what they needed to do to be able to see, to witness that Jesus, whom they loved, whom they followed, that they could see his body there in the tomb? Could they push through the layers of fear and anxiety of Pilate and other leaders that manifested in that sealed tomb? Could they move the power of security that the world had put in front of Jesus' body? Well, they get there, and what happens? I can only imagine how the Marys felt. First, we have an earthquake. So that must have been, at best, disturbing, but more likely terrifying. The earth shaking. And if that's not enough, here are these two women standing there, and coming down out of heaven is an angel. He looks like lightning. And apparently he is wearing some clothing, because we hear that his clothing looks like snow. And this lightning being, he moves the stone. Now, we don't really know if it's hard for the angel to move the stone, but I personally like to imagine that the stone, which I think that someone like Andre the Giant could barely shove at all, that the angel just comes up to this stone and kind of pushes it over like it's no big deal. And he has a seat, you know, he just sits down on it. The guards are there. They're more security, right? The last bastion against the fear of Jesus and Jesus' followers. Those guards, they pass out cold. Matthew says that they become like dead men. The security that the world, the empire, has tried to put around Jesus to keep Jesus out because they were afraid. That security is nothing. And the women, I imagine they're at least a little rattled, but they don't pass out, right? They listen to the angel. Now, I have to tell you, I love angels. They know that they must look awesomely scary and amazing, because almost always their opening line is what? Do not be afraid. Exactly. So here, this angel is no exception. We are getting to see, we are getting to experience how God is in the process of triumphing. I invite you to look with me through the eyes of the Marys. They hear from the angel. They see that Jesus is not there. And then they follow the angel's guidance to go to Galilee. And how do they go? They go with fear, but they go with great joy. And in following the faithful call, they do indeed get to see Jesus. Now, again, the text doesn't elaborate overly much, but I imagine that they are trembling, that they are overjoyed, and when they see Jesus, they fall to his feet and they embrace his feet. They are so happy that he is alive. They worship him then and there. The powers of the world, the powers of death, they have been defeated. And the Marys are there experiencing the moment, and they rejoice and worship. Now, my friends, I don't really have to tell you that this has been one of the most challenging years of most of our lifetimes. Possibly for each of us individually, but also as communities, as nations, as our collective humanity. We have been mourning. We mourn those who have died in this past year. We are grieved by those who are still having COVID affect their health. We grieve the divides in our society. We grieve the brokenness that where we see injustice. But at the same time, we find ourselves in an interesting place. In the same time, we are beginning to anticipate, as we are vaccinated, what responsibly venturing out little by little might look like. This has been a year where we have been working, and we still are, to love our neighbors by not getting physically close to them. Because, as we have learned, COVID works against us and some of our natural human inclinations to gather. COVID and this year have changed our lives, both individually and collectively. And I know that because of it, people have experienced fear. But I pray for all of us that as more and more of us are vaccinated and we begin to do some responsible shifting while still wearing our masks, that we do not allow our fears to keep us from what God is calling us to do next. How are we being called to be the church in this phase of the journey? I'm pretty sure that it's not the same church
that we were this time 2 years ago. Being the church in this new phase might mean something like continuing to offer live streamed services, even though we can safely regather, because we know that even with many being able to safely regather with masks, that there are some who have really not been able to be present with us over an elongated period of time because of their immunocompromised health. And those folks have been more a part of church than in this year than they have gotten to be in the past. Being the church in this time and place might mean that we're doing something bigger and unknown. The women who came to Jesus' tomb, they were afraid. Who wouldn't be? But they responded to the angel's news. And even though they saw the empty tomb, they had both fear, but also great joy. My friends, I invite us to move into this Easter season, this season of the resurrection, knowing that God is with us, that God has defeated the power of death, that God has said that the powers of this world do not have the final say, and that we respond to God, yes, and there will be fear, but I also hope that we say yes with great joy. Alleluia. Amen.
Through the Paschal Mystery, dear friends, we are buried with Christ by baptism into his death and raised with him to newness of life. As we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord and our own participation in that resurrection through the waters of baptism, we remember our baptism into the body of Christ. As we pass through the waters of the font, we also pass with Christ through the grave and gate of death, and are united with Christ in his resurrection. I call upon you, therefore, now that our Lenten observance is ended, to renew the solemn promises and vows of holy baptism, by which we once renounced Satan and all his works, and promised to serve God faithfully in his holy Catholic Church, and to celebrate the baptism of these new Christians. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Will you continue in the Apostles' teaching and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and the prayers?
I will, with God's help.
Will you persevere in resisting evil, and whenever you fall into sin, repent and return to the Lord?
I will, with God's help.
Will you proclaim by word and example the good news of God in Christ?
I will, with God's help.
Will you seek and serve Christ in all persons, loving your neighbor as yourself?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being?
I will, with God's help.
May Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given us new birth by water and the Holy Spirit and bestowed upon us the forgiveness of sins, keep us in eternal life by his grace, in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
We pray to Jesus, who is present with us now and throughout all ages. Jesus, light of the world, bring the light and peace of your gospel to the nations. Turn us from war and to peace, and from violence to understanding. Jesus, Lord of life.
In your mercy, hear us.
Jesus, bread of life, give food to the hungry and care to the outcast. Nourish us with your word, that we may share your love with friend and enemy. Jesus, Lord of life.
In your mercy, hear us.
Jesus, our way, our truth, our life, be with us and all who follow you in the way. Deepen our appreciation of your truth and the cost of discipleship, and fill us with your life. Jesus, Lord of life.
In your mercy, hear us.
Jesus, Good Shepherd, who gave your life for the sheep, recover the straggler, bind up the injured, strengthen the sick, care for all who are anxious and fearful in the wake of this pandemic, and lead the healthy and strong to new pastures. Jesus, Lord of life.
In your mercy, hear us.
Jesus, the resurrection and the life, we give you thanks for all who have lived and believed in you, especially those whom we love but see no longer. Raise us with them to eternal life. Jesus, Lord of life.
In your mercy, hear us. Accept our prayers and be with us always. Amen.
And now let us share this holy paschal flame as a sign of that radiant love and affection of the risen Savior in our lives. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May Almighty God, who has redeemed us and made us God's children through the resurrection of his Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the riches of his blessing.
Amen. May God, who through the water of baptism has raised us from sin into newness of life, make you holy and worthy to be united with Christ forever.
Amen.
May God, who has brought us out of bondage to death into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and remain with you forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.